We have already solved some problems on bar using Rayleigh-Ritz method, and now let us see how to solve a beam problem using this Rayleigh-Ritz method. The steps remain same with slight modification, and now let us see in this session what are those few modifications. Now our first step tells us that this potential energy functional pi, this is nothing but this is strain energy plus work potential. And then the strain energy for beam will not be same as that of strain energy for bar. So in this session we will see what is the strain energy for beam. As we know, beam is the member which takes the transverse load and it undergoes some deflection like this, where this is the vertical deflection, and let us call this vertical deflection as V. So strain energy, as we all know, the strain energy can be given as integral of half into stress into strain times the volume. And then this further I can simplify this as sigma square by 2 e dv, because epsilon, that is strain, is sigma by e. Further, if I use the Fletcher's formula for beam, I know that sigma by y is equal to m by I is equal to e by r. So from this we get sigma is equal to my by I for beam. So if I substitute this stress here, I get this as m square y square by 2 times e I square, and then this dv I can write it as area times dx, because if I consider here a small component of length say dx, and if this cross sectional area is a then this small volume dv I can write it as area times dx. Further, I know that this product y square times a is nothing but moment of inertia I, or second moment of area. So in that case, if I substitute that here, I should get this as m square I by 2 e I square. Then this area multiplied by y square is I, and then this will be dx. So further, if I simplify this, I get this as m square by 2 ei dx. So this is the expression for strain energy of beam. This is the one expression, but again we will not be using this expression in the potential functional. I'll have to slightly modify it in terms of, I want this expression in terms of this vertical displacement V. So what I can do is I can use this expression, I can use the beam equation which we all know, that is EI d square V by dx square. This is nothing but this is equal to the bending moment, and from here I get this d square V by dx square as m by EI. So what I can do here is I can just multiply and divide this term by EI. So in that case I will multiply this term, I will bring this 2 out, and then I will divide this term by EI again, so which gives us m by EI whole square dx. But from this equation I know that m by EI is d square V by dx square, which is second derivative of vertical deflection. And then from here we get now this strain energy expression as EI by 2. This is nothing but this will be d square V by dx square the whole square dx, and this is the expression which we'll be using every time to solve the beam problem using Rayleigh-Ritz method. So whenever I write this potential functional pi is strain energy plus work potential, here the strain energy for beam will be EI by 2 d square V by dx square the whole square times dx, and then this part remains same, work potential. As we know, work potential is force multiplied by the corresponding displacement force multiplied by corresponding displacement. So in this case, if this load is P and then the vertical corresponding displacement or deflection is V, then in this case this work potential will be P multiplied by V, and of course it will be minus, because this minus sign indicates that work is done on this system, because this external force is applied on this system. Now this is when we have a point load on the beam. But if let us say if there is a beam which is subjected to UDL of say P naught per unit length, then this work potential will be, since this is a distributed load, we'll have to integrate this. If I consider one small element of say length dx, then the load on this small element dx will be P naught multiplied by dx. So it will be P naught multiplied by dx, and the corresponding displacement for this load P naught multiplied by dx, let us say that is again V, so it will be V. So this will be work potential will be integral of, suppose say this length is from 0 to L, suppose say this length, beam length is say L. So this will be work potential will be integral of P naught integral of 0 to L V times dx. So this will be the work potential for a beam which is subjected to uniformly distributed load, and this will be the work potential for beam which is subjected to a point load P, and again this should be minus, because again here also work is done on the system. So this tells us that the potential energy functional can be very well written for the beam if we substitute the strain energy expression as this, and the work potential energy expression is either this or this depending upon the given problem. So this was all about the step number one. Now let us see what is step number two. Step number two tells us that the assumed trial function, we need to assume a trial function, and that should satisfy the boundary condition. And this is a very important concept of boundary conditions, because boundary conditions will not be same for all the types of beams, and let us see exactly what are the different boundary conditions. So we have these different types of beams, and we will see one by one what will be the boundary conditions for these different types of beam. But before that, as we had written here, this is our equation of beam. So equation of beam, as we know, is EI d square V by dx square is M. But if I differentiate this equation once, I will get this as EI d cube V by dx cube will be dm by dx, and this is nothing but the first derivative of moment is nothing but the shear force that is acting on the beam. And then similarly, if I differentiate it once more, I will get EI d raised to 4 V by dx raised to 4 is equal to dv by dx is nothing but the distributed load P naught on the beam. And then we know that V is the vertical deflection, and then dv by dx is the slope. The first derivative of vertical deflection is slope. So from here we get to know that V is the vertical deflection, dv by dx is slope, d square V by dx square is the quantity which represents the bending moment, and the third derivative of V, that is d cube V by dx cube, is the quantity which relates the shear force. So V dv by dx, d square V by dx square, and the third derivative d cube V by dx cube are the quantities in this manner. And now let us see how we can use this here for boundary condition. First, we have here a simply supported beam which is hinged at one end and which is rested on the roller support at other end. Now here the boundary conditions at x equal to 0 and at x equal to L will consider this side to be x equal to 0 and will consider this side to be x equal to L. If the length of these beams is L, then and if this is our coordinate system, then this will be the boundary where this x is 0 and this will be the boundary where x is L. And first we have here a simply supported beam which is hinged at one end and which is rested on the roller at other end. Then at x equal to 0, we know that here there is no deflection, though there won't be any deflection. So at x equal to 0, v of 0 will be 0 because there won't be any deflection here in both the beams, which is first beam is simply supported beam which is subjected to the point load P, and the second beam is the simply supported beam which is subjected to the UDL of P naught Newton per mm. So at x equal to 0, we know that the deflection is 0. And in simply supported beam, if you remember, at both the ends the bending moment is also 0. So if bending moment is 0, that means this term is 0, that is EI d square V by dx square will be 0. And if this term is 0, this E is the property of the material and I is the property of the area. So these terms cannot be 0. So only thing that can be 0 if bending moment is 0 is this term. The second derivative of V should be equal to 0. And exactly this is what exactly happens here. Since the bending moment at the ends are 0, therefore D square V by dx square at x equal to 0 will be 0. So these are the boundary conditions at the left hand side, that is at x equal to 0. And at the right hand side, that is at x equal to L, same thing happens. V at x equal to L will be 0. And then the second derivative of V, that is d square V by dx square at x equal to L, will be again 0. So these are the boundary conditions. This is L, not 2. These are the boundary conditions for simply supported beam which are subjected to point load and the uniformly distributed load. Now we have here a beam which is fixed on both the ends, and since it is fixed on both the ends, its slope will be somewhat like this. Here, the slope at the fixed end, we know that the deflection has to be 0 because there won't be any deflection here. But along with the deflection, the slopes will be also 0 because it is fixed at both the ends. So here, the boundary conditions at x equal to 0 will be the vertical deflection will be 0. And also the slope, which is given by the first derivative of the deflection at x equal to 0, will be also 0. And same thing happens at x equal to L here, because the boundary conditions are same on both the side. That is, the vertical deflection here on this side will be equal to, will be at x equal to L will be equal to 0. And again, the slope at x equal to L will be 0. So these are the boundary conditions for the beam which are fixed on both the ends. Then we come to the cantilever beam, which is subjected to a uniformly distributed load of P naught Newton per mm. Now if you look at the left hand side, that is at x equal to 0, we know that the vertical deflection V at x equal to 0 will be 0. And then here, since it is fixed at this side, left side, the slope will be somewhat like this. So this slope here at x equal to 0, the way it was in this case, it was 0. Similarly here, the slope will be 0 at x equal to 0. The slope will be 0. So these are the boundary conditions on the left hand side. But on the right hand side, the vertical deflection is not 0. Right, and also the slope is not 0. The slope as well as the vertical deflection exists, but what will be 0 on the right hand side, that is at x equal to L at this side, the shear force and bending moment will be 0. If you remember from your basic elementary mechanics of solid knowledge, that the bending moment and shear force both should be zero at this free end of the cantilever beam. So since the bending moment is zero, this term should be zero, and then since the shear force is zero, this term, that is d cube v by dx cube, should be equal to zero. So the boundary conditions here are the moment of inertia, that is d square v by dx square at x equal to L should be zero, that is the bending moment is zero, and also the shear force, that is d cube v by dx cube at x equal to L should be equal to zero. So these will be the boundary conditions at the free end of the cantilever beam, which is subjected to uniformly distributed load. And let us see finally what will be the boundary conditions for a cantilever beam which is subjected to point load at the free end. On the left hand side, again this beam is fixed, so this boundary conditions will be same as this, that is the deflection at x equal to 0 is 0 and the slope at x equal to 0 is 0. But what about the boundary conditions on the right hand side? The first boundary condition will remain same, that is the bending moment will be still equal to 0, so this will be same as this, but here the shear force is not equal to zero. The shear force here at the free end will not be equal to zero, but it will be equal to the applied load P in the opposite direction. So the last boundary condition will be d cube v by dx cube, that is the shear force at x equal to L will be equal to minus P. So this is what you need to be very careful with while solving the problems of beam using Rayleigh Ritz method, that this boundary conditions, there will be four boundary conditions for any beam problem, and they will be as follows, and we need to be very careful with this boundary conditions in order to proceed with this problems correctly. So this will take care of our second step, and the third step will remain same as that of the bar problem.